So I want to start with a scenario that you may be familiar with, and it's the following. You log on to your social media platform of choice, and you are immediately inundated with a slew of people presenting their political views, which you think are totally and completely false. And these might come from maybe that family member that you don't really talk to that much, or that friend who's maybe really more of an acquaintance. So for every issue that you think is yes, they think is no, and vice versa. And maybe in the past, you would have seized these disagreements as opportunities to try to convince somebody of what you think is right. After all, you have all sorts of reasons and arguments and evidence in favor of your view, and what better ammunition in a level-headed debate about politics? Well, okay, now in your wisdom and experience, you have come to learn that these kinds of debates, especially the ones that we have online, more often than not lead absolutely nowhere, right? Nobody ends up changing their mind. Everyone just ends up getting pissed off at each other, and everyone just ends up getting frustrated. And what's extra frustrating about this is that we have so many opportunities to be pissed off at people who are wrong, right? This thing is a source of infinite frustration, right? I can fire this up and be mad about someone's terrible political view, and I just do not have enough time in the day to convince everyone on the internet why they are wrong. So you've adopted a new strategy, which is to, for the most part, avoid these kinds of debates, right? Change the subject, don't engage. It's just mostly easier on everyone. And today what I want to talk about are these kinds of really difficult, frustrating kinds of disagreements. And the kind of disagreement that I think is often the most frustrating and what often seems like the least likely to be resolved are moral disagreements. And these are disagreements about things like what's right and wrong, or what kinds of obligations we have to other people, or really just how much we should care about other people in general. And a lot of the time, our most heated political debates really do seem to come down to an underlying moral disagreement. And the disagreement that often seems to underlie these debates is how much I should care about other people. So here's an example. So you and I might disagree about something like whether we should raise minimum wage, or whether people should be required to pay for services that they themselves don't necessarily use. And I might think that you should, and you should really give more if you can give more. And you might think that, well, maybe you give enough, and you shouldn't have to give much more than you are being asked to give already. And our disagreement might really come down to how much of a sacrifice should I be expected to make for the potential well-being of other people? And you and I might disagree about that. And that might be something that underlies our political debates. Now, there are those kinds of people that we occasionally come across who just seem to care about absolutely nobody but themselves. And these are the kinds of people who we engage in the most kind of frustrating disagreements, because we want to convince them that they are wrong. They really should care more about other people, but it's really hard to see how we can convince them. And this is the question I want to ask today. Why are moral disagreements so difficult and so frustrating, and why do they more often than not tend to not get resolved, and why do we not tend to make such good progress on them? Well, I think this is a really complex question, and there's a whole bunch of different facets to it. And I want to mention two facets that I'm not going to talk about. I'm just going to mention them, but I'm going to talk about something else. So here are two facets that make moral disagreements really frustrating and hard to resolve. And the first one is that when we engage in these kinds of disagreements with other people, often the person we're disagreeing with doesn't really want to listen to us, right? They're not really looking to change their beliefs or change their minds or be educated, especially when people are just ranting about stuff online. And it's hard to have a productive disagreement with somebody who's really just not willing to listen to you, right? So that's part of what makes these disagreements so frustrating. Another part of, I think, what makes these disagreements so frustrating is that when we disagree with people about these kinds of fundamental matters, we tend to categorize people who disagree with us as them, and people who agree with us as us, right? And them, they're bad, and we sort of have biases against them, and we don't want to listen to them, and us, we're good, we should listen to us. Okay? So I'm a Canadian, I don't engage in your kind of political debates. We have our own political debates that we engage in. But I take it here in America, something that often happens with political debates is to say, well, you know, I'm a level-headed Democrat, and I don't need to listen to those heartless Republicans. Or maybe I'm a level-headed Republican, and I don't need to listen to those hippie Democrats. or something like that. And this is that sort of us and them mentality. If we think in this way, that's a really big barrier to trying to actually accomplish anything when we talk to one another. Those, I think, are two reasons why these debates can be so frustrating. But I want to focus on a different kind of reason. One that has to do with the way that we have moral debates themselves and the ways in which we convey information to one another and in which we learn from one another. So consider a different kind of debate, a really mundane kind of disagreement. You and I might disagree about, say, when a movie was released, or about how many feet are in a yard, or about what the capital of Indiana is, or something like that. Now, in order to resolve this disagreement, there's something that we can easily do, right? We can consult this. You know, it's not just for frustration anymore, right? It can give us some kind of answer. We can consult this, and we can get the answer, and we can settle our disagreement. Or I might do something like, you know, again, Canadian. I have no idea how your weird imperial measurement system works. So my Canadian friend and I disagree about how many feet are in the yard. I want to know the answer. I'm going to consult you, my American friends, who of course tell me that the answer is... three. Okay, good. Yeah, you're all my American friends, right? So three. So the answer is three. So we've resolved that kind of disagreement, right? And that's the way that we can do that. I can look up stuff online. I can ask people who tell me the answer, and this is a way to resolve the disagreement, right? And of course, there's going to be more complex kind of disagreements. Let's say that you and I are civil engineers, and we're trying to decide where the best place to build that bridge is, and we disagree about that, right? Now, how are we going to resolve this disagreement? Well, we're going to tell each other what we think the right answer is. We're going to try to give each other our reasons. We're going to try to get on the same page, and then we can sort of talk things through and work things out and come to a resolution. Now, of course, not all debates are going to be easily resolved in this kind of way, but this is a way that seems like we can resolve these kinds of disagreements. What it really comes down to is that when we disagree about things, we disagree about things because we know or we think that we know different things from one another. Right? So I know or I think that I know something different than you know or that you think that you know. So in order for us to make progress on our disagreement, what we can do is we can share our knowledge with each other. Right? We can share and gain knowledge in order to get on the same page and then try to make some progress on this disagreement and to reach a resolution. But this doesn't seem to be what happens in the case of moral debates, right? In moral disagreements. I cannot look up online how much of a personal sacrifice I should make for the potential well-being of others. Right? I mean, I probably can, right? I can Google that. Ask Google how much of a personal sacrifice should I make for the potential well-being of others, and it will give me some sort of slew of answers. But I'm not going to resolve our debate by pointing to the internet and say, look, it says you should care more about other people, in the way that I can point to the internet and say, well, look, it says that Indianapolis is the capital of Indiana, right? That resolves our debate. But this other thing, me pointing to the internet about this other matter, is not going to resolve our moral disagreement. And us, even us getting on the same page, right? I might very well know where you stand about an issue. You know where I stand about an issue, and that might not help us make any progress on our moral disagreement. If I think you should do more to help people and you think you're doing plenty enough, then it seems like we've run out of conversation, right? We've reached a stalemate. But this is not any kind of progress. So what's the difference here? Why are our moral disagreements so much more difficult to resolve than our other kinds of disagreements? And here's what I want to suggest today. In order to resolve these other kinds of maybe more mundane kinds of cases of disagreements, we need to share and gain new knowledge. But when it comes to moral disagreements, what we need to do is something else. We need to share and gain new understanding. That's the line I want to try to give you today. And understanding, much more so than knowledge, seems to require that we not just take somebody's word for it, that we really grasp the reasons why something is true. And this might not be something that we can really do just by you telling me what you think is the right answer. So here's an example. Let's say I want to know, I don't know what the capital of Indiana is, and I want to figure out what the answer is. Well, I look it up online, or I ask you, my American friends, and you tell me what the answer is, and the answer is Indianapolis, and now I've come to know. And by doing that, I've done everything that could be reasonably expected of me when it comes to the question of what is the capital of Indiana. And I've looked it up, it's Indianapolis, I know it, I'm done. But things seem to be different when it comes to moral questions. If I'm unsure about whether I should lie to you or whether I should steal from you, you expect me to not just think that it's wrong because the internet told me or because somebody told me, but you expect me to really understand why I shouldn't do this to you. It's not enough to say that, well, I'm not going to lie to you because Google told me not to, right? I have to grasp the reasons why it would be wrong to do this, and that's what we expect. So here's generally what I want to say about what it means to have understanding. To understand something, you've got to not only think that something is true, but you've really got to grasp the reasons why it's true. And here's what I think is relevant to our question about moral debates. When it comes to morality, when it comes to questions about what right and wrong and obligations, we're expected to not merely know what I should do because I read it or because somebody told me, but we're expected to really understand why it's the case, to really grasp the reasons why it's true. Now, if you like that, if you're sort of with me so far, now we can try and make a little bit more sense of why our moral disagreements can be so frustrating. We're tempted to try to resolve our disagreements by pointing to facts, things that we look up online, or things that we just think is the case. And that might be a way to share knowledge with one another, but it's not necessarily a way to share understanding with each other. And if morality requires really that we understand and not just know, in order to make progress on our moral debates, we need to think more about what it means to share understanding and to gain new understanding. Now, if this is the problem, what's the solution? Well, we need to think more about how we might share our understanding with each other. And this might require more than just, again, looking up things online or asking people. This might require us doing something more like helping somebody to see something from a new perspective, or to draw connections between beliefs that they have that they didn't realize before, or to maybe help somebody have a new experience in order to understand in a way that they couldn't before. This might not always be able to be done just by talking to one another, or by leaving comments on tweets, or by looking up things online. Now, if this is the case, right, we need to think more about how I could, we might still, even though we might not be able to convey understanding solely in these kinds of ways, in the way that we convey knowledge, in the way that we resolve other kinds of disagreements, we might still be able to accomplish something by talking to one another. Right? If we have a moral disagreement, the way to resolve this is not by pointing at facts or necessarily saying something because somebody told me it was the case. But something that I might try to do is to talk to you in a way to help you understand to see things from my perspective. So I might share my experiences with you by telling you about them. Or I might try to challenge assumptions that you've made in the past to make you see things differently. Right? Our words still might be able to help us make progress on these moral debates, even if the progress that we make on this debate, these debates, is not the same as the way we make progress on other kinds of debates. So this is what I really want to push, right? Morality requires of us that we not merely just know that something is the case because somebody told us or because we read it, but really that we grasp the reasons why and really that we understand it. So what have we accomplished in the last 10 or so minutes here? Right? Well, I don't think I've given you a surefire way of solving all your moral disagreements in the future, or besting your political rivals, or winning all your career views, or anything like that. But what I have tried to do is try to put my finger on an aspect of moral disagreements, but what makes them so frustrating that maybe we don't pay enough attention to, which is that in order to resolve these disagreements, we need to do something different than when we resolve or try to resolve other kinds of disagreements. Right? Other kinds of disagreements can be resolved perhaps by sharing and gaining knowledge, moral disagreements by sharing and gaining understanding. So when we have our disagreements, what we might need to do is think more about what we're really trying to accomplish in having a moral disagreement or having a moral debate. And in that, we need to think more about how we can best share our understanding.